The first thing to disappear from the grocery shelves was toilet paper. Do you remember that? When the pandemic began, people hoarded enough toilet paper to last till kingdom come. Next to go were staples like rice, beans, pasta, sugar, yeast, and flour. That's right, flour. Flour sales went through the roof. The stay-at-home order led to more baking at home. And that's a healthy change. People dusted off their mixing bowls and bread pans and started baking bread. Why bread? Not because they need the dough. Okay, that's a bad pun, I know, but it does fit. It turns out that bread is the ultimate comfort food. It's the most basic staple next to water. We talk about breaking bread as both a physical act and a spiritual bond. Bread is the staff of life. In today's gospel, Jesus feeds 5,000 with 5 loaves of bread. And that's not counting the women and children who were present. The math behind that physical act boggles the imagination. But the spiritual bond is easy to understand. When we break bread together, the fraction leads to action. We actually unite. We share one bread, one body. That's why the sacrament of the altar is so central to worship. It connects us with the community. We remember that we belong to the communion of saints. It's not the bread alone that does these things. It's what Jesus says, his words that invite and promise. Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Right now, there is no safe way for us to gather in person for communion. So we do the next best thing. After we record the worship service, we make the bread available at the entrance of the church. We send communion to those who are homebound. And right now, that's most of us. When we eat this bread, we share the body of Christ. The bread alone doesn't do it. It's Christ's words of invitation and promise given for you. Welcome to worship. Welcome to Lord of Life. Today's worship service features music written by our very own Minister of Music, Gloria Lee, and member Marcia Kletz. And may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Now, who's ready to eat? Thank you.
Let us pray. Glorious God, your generosity nourishes the world with goodness, and you cover creation with abundance. Awaken in us a hunger for the food that satisfies both body and spirit. And with this food, fill our starving world through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
The gospel for today is Matthew chapter 14, verses 13 through 21. Now when Jesus heard this, he withdrew from there in a boat to a lonely place apart. But when the crowds heard it, they followed him on foot from the towns. As he went ashore, he saw a great crowd, and he had compassion on them, and he healed their sick. When it was evening, the disciples came to him and said, "This is a lonely place, deserted, and the day is now over. Send the crowds away to go into the villages to buy food for themselves." Jesus said, "They do not need to go away. You give them something to eat." They said to him, "We have only 5 loaves here and 2 fish. Jesus said, "Bring them here to me." Then he ordered the crowds to sit down on the grass, and taking the 5 loaves and the 2 fish, he looked up to heaven and blessed and broke and gave the loaves to the disciples, and the disciples gave them to the crowds, and they all ate and were satisfied, and they took up 12 baskets full of the broken pieces left over. And those who ate were about 5,000 men, besides women and children. The Gospel of the Lord. This gospel reading from Matthew 14 is commonly called the feeding of the 5,000. We know from Matthew's gospel that there were actually more than 5,000, as that last verse conveniently included women and children. 10,000, 12,000, it was a mass feeding. One of the interesting facts about this too. This miracle story is found in all four of our Gospels with varying degrees on amounts of people being served. But we have it in all four. It made that much of an impression at the time. It made that much of an impression when the Gospels were being put together. It made that much of an impression that as the church was being formed and as we were figuring out who we were and what we were to be about and what teachings and activities of Jesus were so important to be included, that this made it in all four of the Gospels. I think that's remarkable. The other thing is that I find three miracles happening in this miracle story, the miracle of the feeding. I find three. So the first one is that the crowds even showed up. All it just says is the people followed him on foot from the towns. Well, how did so many people just happen to be following him by foot? We don't have a whole lot of detail, but I sort of imagine word about Jesus was spreading, which was, of course, what needed to have happened. They'd heard about his teachings. He hadn't necessarily done anything like this grand scale before, but I could see if a few people were heading out of town or heading out of the villages, and others would ask, well, where are you going? And word spread about, well, there's this preacher in the wilderness, and he healed somebody down the street, and maybe something like that will happen today. And word would just spread, but still, 10,000, 12,000? I just think it's a miracle that there were that many people gathered at one place at one time to listen to Jesus, to stay all day to seek him out. That was one of the three miracles. The second thing I consider a miracle is that Jesus' compassion knows no bounds. I know, that's an obvious one. The idea that he would feed this throng of people and have compassion that has no end just seems, of course, he's God. But I think it's worth being said, it's not just the feeding that happened, but the healing of the sick. When he got out of the boat and saw the crowd, the first thing he thought of was he wanted to heal their sick. How many people did he lay hands on? How many people did he pray over? He must have been exhausted. 5,000, 10,000, 12,000. That was a miracle. And the third miracle, I'll get to a little bit later. The context of this miracle story is important to note. So right before our verses start, at the beginning of Matthew 14, John the Baptist is killed, beheaded by King Herod. It starts with King Herod celebrating his birthday, and it goes on to explain why John the Baptist is in prison. He had called Herod and his wife Herodias adulterers because Herodias had been married to his brother Philip, and Herod took her from him and married him, and John was very happy to report to anyone that would listen that they were adulterers, and Herod couldn't stand that. But even with all his power and authority and money and backers, King Herod was afraid to do anything to John except have him arrested, because he knew that the people saw John as a prophet. And Herod was Jewish. He may not have been the best practicing of the Jews of the day, but he was Jewish, and he understood the importance of the prophetic voice. Even if he didn't believe John was a prophet, he understood the people did, and that's what he was afraid of. Besides, prophets and kings in the Old Testament didn't exactly always get along. So he didn't mind having him in jail, but he was still a little afraid of him. So then at this birthday party Matthew 14, he has his stepdaughter dance for him, and he's so enthralled by this dance that he promises her anything she wants. And she asks her mom, and her mom, of course, really wants to get rid of the John problem. So she has him behead John, and not just behead him, but then put his head on a platter and have it displayed. I mean, it's just horrendous. But King Herod, because he said this vow in front of his guests, he can't back down. What kind of a man would that be? So he beheads this innocent man in jail and brings out his head as some sort of trophy. Absolutely horrifying. The last verse of that little story says how John's disciples went and collected his body, and then they went to tell Jesus what had happened. That's the ending of that. And our story starts with now when Jesus heard this. And so we can only imagine that this is happening immediately after or close to after he has just heard this. Now when Jesus has heard this, he withdrew himself to a quiet place. He went out in a boat to be by himself. He was so upset by this story. Is that reading into it too much? I don't think so. We understand that Jesus and John had a relationship. Were they related? Were they kinspeople? Well, their mothers, according to Luke's gospel, were kinswomen. Were they cousins? Were they aunt to niece? We don't know, but it's mentioned that they were related. That would make Jesus, the son of Mary, and John, the son of Elizabeth, related. But even if they weren't part of that same lineage, however you understand that lineage, even if they weren't, Jesus and John were connected. Some of John's first disciples, Andrew, for one, became Jesus' disciple. And so they were connected by their followers. They were connected by their terrain. They were connected by John's pronouncement in John's gospel, in Mark's gospel, that Jesus was the one who was the light of the world, the one coming into the world. So we can imagine that, yes, Jesus was in mourning. And he went off by himself. And in the meantime, the crowds show up. He comes back to shore and sees these people, this crowd, and he has compassion on them. He's the one that needed some compassion. He's the one that probably needed somebody to pray over him. And yet his first thought is to this crowd gathered, and what do they need? Let me take care of their ills. Let me lay my hands on them, heal their sick, and be that presence for them of God. So we have this huge crowd, 10, 12,000, not quite a football stadium, but it had to have been a sea of people. How did you see anything beyond this crowd of people? And so Jesus himself, just by himself, doing all that for those people gathered, that is a miracle, the second miracle. The crowd's the first, his compassion the second. They listened, they waited, they were healed. So then, all day long, we don't know when he started the healing, but the verse talks about now it's evening. And the disciples must have been watching the clock, or at least the sun, and so they understand that it's time to send the crowd away. And I love how they actually do this. They tell Jesus, send the crowd away so that they can go home and buy their own food. Send them away, Jesus. They've tried this before, telling Jesus what to do, and it never works out well for them. Instead, he turns this right back on the disciples. You give them something to eat. You give them something to eat. You give them something to eat. It may not have been a harsh thing that he was saying to them, but he was sharing his compassionate nature with them. You give them something to eat. That's what we do. So I don't often look up numbers because it's very distressing, but in preparation for this sermon, I did. I went on to the Lutheran World Hunger website and had the number staring at me in the face, that 820 million people, more than 1 in 10 in the world, are hungry. We call it food insecurity, which just sounds strange. I just say they're hungry. They're maybe even starving. 820 million. The number for the people in the United States is listed at 40 million. Over 40 million people in the United States aren't sure where their next meal is coming from. But that's from 2017. That's already 3 years old, and I can't even imagine what COVID-19 has done to that number, except enlarge it by thousands, maybe millions. I don't like looking at those numbers because it is distressing. So then I decided to look at different numbers. And this, of course, is probably the least accurate that I could ever come up with, but you Google hungry people in the first century Galilee, where Jesus was doing this miracle, and there's actually some articles that pop up. And one of the articles said, based it on some other information that was happening in other Roman territories, other Roman-controlled lands, which of course was all around the Mediterranean, and they came up with this figure of possibly 9 out of 10 lived at barely making it levels. Those are my words. 9 out of 10 barely made it, wondering where their next meal was coming from. In fact, they would probably spend a whole day thinking about where the meal's going to come from and then have the meal, whatever it could consist of, and then the next day start all over again. And this article talked about with Roman occupation, there was no middle class. There was the Romans, the people under them, the higher-ups, the people that owned land, the people that were that hired other people, the peasants, and then there were just the peasants. We don't use that word anymore, but it's fitting for that time. There was inequity built in to the Roman domination of that area. Inequity was just built in to how they maintained control. Keep the masses underfoot, keep them unsettled, keep them underfed, and then they'll be too busy trying to survive to cause any trouble. I doubt if that was actually written down somewhere, that sort of theory about how to keep them under control. But when you think about it, it makes a lot of sense. You keep them unsettled, underfed, underfoot. They'll be so busy trying to survive, they won't think about complaining about the oppression that's keeping them so hungry. So it's not surprising that the disciples wanted the crowds to go away. Even then, people don't like to look at other hungry people. People don't like to look at masses of people that need something. It makes us uncomfortable. It made the disciples uncomfortable in a very practical way, but it is overwhelming. The first time I took a youth group to Haiti was the summer of 2001. I took 10 kids and 4 other adults and myself, and we had many, many meetings about what we were going to do there and how it was going to happen, and I tried my best to prepare them for what they were going to see. You can go online and find pictures, and that's one thing, and then my words and my experience was another thing. I tried to tell them that they would see children in the city called City Soleil, City of the Sun. That's actually the poorest of the poor. It's where Mother Teresa has her hospital and her convent. It's where the Brothers of Charity have their convent, have their home for children. The poorest of the poor, that they would see children without clothes, young little toddlers, their bellies would be distended, which would give the false impression that they were full, but it's really malnourishment that causes that state of their stomach, their abdomen. And their hair, rather than being the black afro that they would normally have, being African descent, would be tinged with orange. And they'd be little and they'd be clinging to another person around them to probably keep them from falling over. As we would drive through the streets, we would just see this over and over again. I wanted to prepare them for that. That all of this, the orange hair, the stomachs were part of how they are starving. So what were we going to do? We went there and we stayed at St. Joseph's Home for Boys and made wonderful relationships. And now 19 years later, I'm still hearing from some of these kids who are no longer kids, married with their own children, that talk to me and remind me about things that happened during that time. And one thing, which I didn't know about for years, later, was how they all, to a one, without my knowing it, left everything they could leave. Extra shoes, extra clothes, money, which I would have really had them not do. They left everything they could possibly leave the day we left. And they gave it to the boys at St. Joseph's Home, even though a lot of them were girls in this trip. But the idea was that the boys at St. Joseph's were paid for their chores that they performed. And they were paid for other jobs that they did in the neighborhood. And because of that, they would have to give a tithe. Brother Michael raised them well. And when you're given something, you give back. And so the boys each had to tithe something of what they earned. And it went specifically to families in City Soleil, the poorest of the poor, those children we were seeing, those hovels we were seeing. Every boy, all 30 of them, adopted a family in City Soleil. And so the girls and the boys knew if they left shoes or clothes or even money, that the boys at St. Joseph's would take it to where it was needed the most. I had no idea they had done that. I had no idea that they had been impacted like that, to want to leave all their things, except literally the clothes on their backs. And how all these years later, they're still impacted. I just got a message even last week from somebody wanting to know how to get something to Haiti. You can't possibly mail it to Haiti. You have to do it in a roundabout way to get it there. Nobody wants to see the faces of the hungry, the bodies ravaged by starvation. It's overwhelming. It makes me feel guilty. But why should it? Instead, I think about how it motivates me, as it motivated those high school kids to leave their belongings. You give them something to eat. You give them something to eat. Jesus' words, simply said, were probably met with such horror at the time for these disciples. How are we going to do this when all we have are 5 loaves and 2 fish? You give them something to eat. This is the third miracle, not the changing of 5 loaves and 2 fish into enough for the hoard, but the fact that these words motivate us even today. You give them something to eat. Jesus has not given up on us. Jesus is feeding our faith, not the literal feeding of bread and fish, but he's feeding our faith with these words. I'm going to call them even a commandment. You give them something to eat. He was talking to his disciples for sure, but he's talking to us today, absolutely. Through the I Help program from Lutheran Social Services, Lord of Life, you are helping the homeless transition off the streets, even in the middle of this COVID. There's a handful of people, a dozen or so, that made a pledge for 90 days to go into this program, to learn how to handle a job interview, to accept clothing that they could wear for these job interviews, and to every night be in a different place, a church mostly, and be fed. And this congregation is providing meals, I think, even twice a week, providing it carefully, social distancing, quarantining, but people are cooking and sharing to make sure that program in these uncertain times still happens. You give them something to eat. Through our gratitude giving, Grace Lutheran Downtown and the homeless ministry, we packed sandwiches. There were 2 weeks in July that we packed sandwiches. It wasn't as many as before. Even the homeless are social distancing. It wasn't 200 a day, a lot less, in fact. And yet, people still came to Lord of Life very carefully. We're separated at different tables and packed hundreds of sandwiches during those 2 weeks, and they were sent down. Thank you for coming, and even in the midst of worrying about being together in a group, we kept it small, we kept it safe. They came and they made sandwiches. Why? Because Jesus says, you give them something to eat. And we did. That's the third miracle. Jesus still hasn't given up on us. He knows we read his word. He knows our faith is strong, needs to be fed, but he never gives up on us. I can't stand it when I think about the fact that 1 in 5 children in Maricopa County goes to bed hungry. That just makes it a little harder when you think about the kids. I don't like to think about how even the homeless aren't going into shelters to get away from the heat because they're afraid of this COVID. And I think about all the other hungry that aren't numbers, that didn't make it into the statistics. And I'm talking about your neighbors up the street, next door. I know with these uncertain times, with the worries about savings and our unstable markets, that I know people are worried. And I know some people don't want food delivered because they don't trust who might be delivering it. I know there are people that you know that are going through extraordinarily difficult times. But I also know that this congregation reaches out when no one is looking. And you know your neighbors, or you know the stories your neighbors say of somebody else's neighbor. And if there's any way you can help, you will. Whether it's calling the church and asking us what we can do, or if you find another system in your neighborhood that can reach out and help, you do it. Why? Because Jesus hasn't given up on us. because Jesus knows we've heard those words and we've taken them to heart. You give them something to eat. The third miracle. Amen.
Let us proclaim together our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. As we join together today in the prayers of the people, our response is, hear our prayer. Confident of your care and helped by the Holy Spirit, we pray for the church, the world, and all who are in need. You take resources that appear to be meager, bless them, and there is enough and more. May your church trust that what you bless and ask us to share with the world is abundant and sufficient. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Your bountiful creation offers sustenance and life for all creatures. Protect this abundance for the well-being of all. Reverse the damage we have caused your creation. Teach us to be caregivers for all that you have made and generously given to us. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. You offer yourself to all the nations and peoples of the earth, inviting everyone to abundant life. Bring the prophetic vision to fullness. May leaders of nations find their wisdom and their joy in you. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. You open your hand and satisfy the desire of every living thing. Hear the anguish of tender hearts who cry to you in suffering and satisfy their deepest needs. Bring wholeness and healing to those who suffer in body, heart, soul, and mind. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. You freely offer the fullness of salvation. Give us, at Lord of Life, your heart for welcome, that our words and actions may extend your free and abundant hospitality to all whom we encounter. We pray today for the ministries of Gloria de Cristo Lutheran Church and their pastor, Reverend William Tim. Bless them as they too welcome all into their midst. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. You gather your saints as one, united in the body of Jesus. Bring us with all your saints to the heavenly banquet. We remember with love and thanksgiving the saints that we have known and that have gone before us. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. In the certain hope that nothing can separate us from your love, we offer these prayers to you through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. Holy God, our Maker, Redeemer, and Healer, in the harmonious world of your creation, the plants and animals, the seas and stars were whole and well in your praise. When sin had scarred the world, you sent your Son to heal our ills and to form us again into one. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, and gave thanks. He broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Remembering, therefore, his acts of healing, his body given up, and the victory over death, we await the day when all peoples of the earth will come to the river to enjoy the tree of life. Send your spirit upon this meal, as grains scattered on the hillside become one bread. So let your church be gathered from the ends of the earth, that all may be fed with the bread of life, your Son. Through him, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, with the Holy Spirit, in your holy church, both now and forever. Amen. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Jesus invites us to the table and gives us the promise of forgiveness and life. This is the body of Christ, and this is the blood of Christ. Body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you always in God's grace. The God of steadfastness and encouragement grant you to live in harmony with one another in accordance with Christ Jesus. The God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing, that you may abound in hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. And may the God of all grace bless you now and forever. Amen.